Thunder, that's for sure.
No, I don't think hardly. So at all.
You guys,
I
absolutely. You guys, I mean, it's, you're going to have always to go through the take whole the bait.
Some of the issues and some of the...
Hi there. My name is Tara Cornelli, and I'm the community producer of this show, The Opinionators. And before we continue on to our first topic, I will introduce you to our show moderator, Larry Deani.
Well, thank you very much, Tara, and welcome to The Opinionators. I am Larry Deani. And our panel was just talking, just before the show gets started, about a number of things. They were talking about the liberal budget that seemed, at least in part, to have been leaked by Mr. Hudak this past week. We're going to talk about that. We're also going to talk about the fact that the continuing saga of the so-called scandal about computers in the Premier's office. We're going to talk about some nasty nominations happening across the country and the marijuana muddle that the federal government has gotten us into. Plus, I'm going to talk about the war on cars. But before we do all of that, let's meet our panel. And, of course, you've already met our community producer, Tara Cornelli of the Conservative Party, dressed in royal blue today.
Of course. Hi, Larry.
And right across from her with a tinge of orange somewhere, is it? I'm colorblind, so I don't know. But I'm assuming there's
pink,
some
Larry.
Orange. All right. A tinge of pinky orange. And, of course, it's Alex Johnstone. Alex, welcome.
Hi there, Larry.
And I know you have no red, because I can tell that. Okay. Ron Corsini.
Not supposed
he's
to wear
wearing
red
his true
on,
blue colors today.
No, I'm not supposed to wear red within these lights. But I just want to say a shout out to the homework club at St. Patrick's School, how hard they're working.
All right. And this is the first time you've ever obeyed rules about what to wear on this show,
yes.
By the way. But listen, let's get right to it, because we were starting to talk about it. And this past week, Mr. Hudak, right after he made some accusations and the NDP walked out, because the Premier wasn't there on the first day back to talk about the computer scandal. We'll talk about that next. But Mr. Hudak pointed out that the Liberals have a plan for a budget that's coming on May the 1st, apparently, with a whole bunch of spending that's going to happen, including some spending for Hamilton. So the question is this. Did Hudak do the right thing in leaking this? And who's this going to? This is going to you, Ron. Did Hudak do the right thing in leaking this? Or was he delivering a message for Kathleen Wynne? Was
I
it purposeful?
I think he was delivering a message for Kathleen Wynne. And I got to thank Mr. Hudak for delivering that, because there are some items on the leaked document, like $300 million to help low-income families, low-income workers, $730 million to tackle waiting lists for developmental services for children with autism, index the Ontario Child Tax Credit for lower-income families, and
LRT money. Are you part of the communications plan for the Liberals? Is that what you're doing?
Well, I just want to tell you all the great news.
Well, but we
that's
don't
coming.
Know. Let's go to Alex, and we'll come back
this
to you.
This is great.
We don't really know, because the budget isn't out yet. And in fact, if indeed it was a legitimate leak, maybe they'll change some of those issues. But it seemed to me that your leader, Andrew Horvath, was a little ticked that the Conservatives changed the channel on the next topic we'll talk about, which is the scandal. Do you think that Hudak was carrying the Liberals' water? Did he take a bait? Or did he do the right thing in warning us of what might come next?
I'm sure Kathleen Wynne is sitting right now writing a thank you letter to Hudak. He absolutely took the bait. This is, you know, typical where the Liberals put something out there and Hudak always takes the bait. He certainly did during the last election. I really have no hope in this guy. He just doesn't seem to understand politics. The only person asking, you know, questions about the gas power plants this past week was Andrea Horvath. She's asking for there to be a criminal probe in an investigation into the power plants. This was, you know, a perfect opportunity for Wynne to change the channel, trying to get some good news for her out there. We have to wonder, though, really, is it good news? Because although you're announcing all kinds of money, and although you say that it's completely accounted for, items such as the pension plan are missing, as are the transit. So
well,
we have to wonder.
No,
we have to wonder, how are
plan.
You going to pay for that? And you know, are you going to be selling off places like the LCBO?
No, you know,
what are you going to be
for
doing
it through the pockets of taxpayers, as per usual? That's what they always do. I think that we needed to get this document out there.
it doesn't necessarily document everything that is going to be happening in the election, but it's giving us just a glance at what the Liberals intend to do and how they intend to use the bureaucrats on our tax dollars to get their message across every day.
Well, they're using,
and that's what the issue is. They're going every day. They're going to be giving
media tax dollars
ideas
to get their message out
every day up until May 1st. Now they're going to have to change it to May 8th because they already have egg
on
their face.
Talk about News 4 Hamilton. You mentioned that some of there was
$730 million that even Ted McMeekin himself. Why wouldn't he know about
that?
I don't even think that money is coming to Hamilton.
Hamilton has to get its act together. And whether we want it, yes or no, because there seems to be
Ron,
a lot of confusion.
You can't continue to buy Ontarians. You cannot buy votes.
Premier
that's exactly what you tried to do the last election.
No, let me stop this.
This is the same liberal trick.
Hang on. We are going to be able to talk about the budget once the official budget comes out. Right now, it's just conjecture. And as Tara said correctly, I think, not all the details are out there.
No.
So let's not take the bait
as well. This is a strategy because
let's keep the discussion to that. Was it a good strategy for your leader to really change the channel on the previous day's discussion around the gas plants? Now, don't talk about gas plants.
We've got a fancy TV that can watch two channels at the same time, Larry.
Okay.
We don't just have a one-track mind. So I think that this is just giving us extra fuel to battle
the Liberals with. But, people like spending. They don't want to pay for it,
but they understand that our economy is in the tank. Our economy is worse than that of California. We cannot afford to pay for everything, unfortunately. We can't. We have to rein in spending, and the Liberals are showing once again that they're not able to do that.
Okay, just on the strategy part, Ron, and then we'll come for a last comment from you. On the strategy part, do you think Premier Wynne was happy that this leak, and maybe was planned, but do you think she was happy that it was the budget, the communications plan was leaked? Or is she a little miffed that if there's a mole within her government, she's unhappy about that?
No, I don't think so. I think that if it was done on purpose and it was leaked to Mr. Hudak and he let it out, a lot of these items on there may or may not get passed or may not even make the
you
light of day.
You were just toting them all,
but
Ron.
Those are items, you know what? Those are items that are put out there. Those are items that are put out there to read the people of Ontario.
Okay. And given that it's increasing spending, which the NDP has in the past at least liked, is this going to take away some of the, is this going to blunt some of the criticism about this government not being interventionist enough in the province?
Well, I think that this is just another Liberal strategy to buy votes. You know, they put forward these NDP motions, because it has been the NDP that has put forward these motions for years. And it's not just NDP motions. These are bills that are in the best interests of Ontarians. It's
and
the
that's
pension.
Exactly what the Liberal government of Ontario believes.
You do it at the last minute.
I'm
you
so
do it when
you're
losing. Pull out your gas plants when you're losing. You
we're
put in
the
items
polls.
For the public only when you're losing.
All right. So let's go to the gas plants.
It's only NDP that has the best interests.
Well, this is your you start on this one, Alex. And it does have to do with the gas plants and the recent revelations that the individual that supposedly, not supposedly, well, allegedly, I guess, because it hasn't been proved in court, erased many computers within the Premier's office and actually was on contract until about a week or so ago. What do you make of that? Is it hurtful, or does it really prove, because he's still on contract, that the Premier and her team knew nothing about him at all, given that he hadn't been removed if he had done something wrong?
Well, Larry, I don't think that Ontarians buy that Kathleen Wynne knew nothing of this, and I don't think that they buy that she knew nothing about the individual that deleted all the records. I mean, certainly the gas power plants have been, you know, the biggest thing hanging over her head since she got started, and you're telling me that she didn't bother to ask, you know, who erased the documents? You're telling me that she asked no questions? I mean, if that really is the case, and I have concerns about her leadership, I don't buy for a minute that she had plans to always be out of the, out of Queen's Park for Monday. Certainly, there's two of the different services that she went to go visit, a seniors home as well as a university, said that they got the call only on Saturday. So for her to say that she was, out of office on Monday and that it was a long-term trip,
we don't buy it. I think that we can agree that she was trying to avoid it for as long as possible. This is really, really damning new evidence. There is a police probe. People are going to be charged at some point. They say it could be months before they know exactly which dates the erasing of files occurred. But this is like more House of Cards than anything I've seen happen in this government. There's so much intrigue and destruction of information and secrecy and lying. And I don't know if Kathleen Wynne, even if she was not aware of it, I don't know if she can actually outrun it in this next election.
The leadership
because this
under
is,
Kathleen
this
Wynne,
is
you know
going
what?
On all liberals.
Fine. You two could say whatever you please, and obviously you're going to stick to whatever you believe in. Kathleen Wynne has been extremely cooperative with this investigation. All right, she has not put up any roadblocks at all, and I believe her when she says that she knew nothing of it. And I find it extremely damning and damaging that Hudak would come out and deflame her, and she has every right to press charges against
She's trying to throw the law at us, trying to stop the opposition from calling her out.
He's lying.
If she had nothing to do with it,
accusations
because he looks at what's happening, and this person was still employed by the party.
Yeah.
So
you just add one plus one. There's no excuse for ignorance.
You know what?
At this point.
When the premier says she is cooperating with the summit, allow the investigation. Allow the investigation to continue, and Premier Wynne will make everything available to the investigation.
Listen, this is politics. And in politics, you don't want investigations to continue and facts to be established. You want to be able to spin them. You're spinning them. That's just the name of the game.
Spinning the facts.
Let's go on to the next topic, because this next topic...
You're spinning them.
This next topic... has to do with nomination fights. And I think all parties have said that they're going to be open, transparent nominations. This is for you, Tara. All across the country. And at the federal level, we've seen that Justin Trudeau has interfered with what he perceived to be bullying of a sitting member, and he stopped that. And even talk about House of Cards, even more perhaps damaging is what's happening in the new riding of North Burlington North, where an MP from another area drops herself in. Her boyfriend, who happens to be the chair of your party, interferes with that. He gets fired, and now she's being investigated by none other than the premier himself. What do you make of all that?
Yeah, it's quite a story, Larry. No, it really is. There's no two ways about it. We've seen things happen in the Liberal camp. I'm sure in the NDP camp there are nomination battles too that we don't hear of. But this is an interesting one only because this is a sitting member hopscotching past boundaries into a new riding before a nomination process has even taken place and saying, yes, I'm running here. It opens up a lot of questions. Should there be open nominations in every riding, even for MP-held ridings? That's something that I think that a party should protect their MPs that are sitting so that they don't have to do a fight before they do their next fight. Then secondly, should the leaders, I know Justin Trudeau has stepped in on a few occasions, and Prime Minister Stephen Harper as well, should you step into a nomination race and say, no, I don't think that you should be running for our party, and I want this other candidate to run instead? That doesn't respect the grassroots. The grassroots are the ones that have to decide on the candidate in an open race. So in this particular instance, I don't think you'll see something like this happening again, because you've got a star candidate from 2011. You've got someone quite at the head of the party being involved, and Dimitri was involved for love, and it was the party versus his girlfriend who he lives with and who I'm sure he wants to marry. So that's a tough one.
Well, Alex, I don't know your party. At least I don't recall them getting involved in a nasty nomination fight. Am I missing something?
Not that I know of.
All right.
Not too many people want to run.
Let's make something
up. You don't have too many people wanting to run.
Well, what do you think about this, though? Is it unseemly for these kinds of things to happen, or is it just politics?
Well, the irony doesn't escape me in that, on one hand, Harper is wanting to investigate Eve's misuse of data, yet he won't cooperate with Elections Canada into the robocalls and the misuse of data by the Conservative Party. So that certainly was a little ironic there. I think that I want to look at Eve herself, and I read some really interesting material this past week. I think her strategy was flawed, you know, that she was going in looking to pick fights, really fights that she didn't need to pick. I think that she probably could have been far more successful had she offered the olive branch. I think certainly Tara does offer some questions about should candidates or MPs have to fight to hold their seat. I think they should. Certainly we're going to see in Alberta and in a couple of different areas under the Conservative Party where current MPs are going to have their seat contested or their nomination contested because they're not seen to be doing work for the riding and they're not seen to be good representatives.
Yeah. Yeah, you're exactly. Ron? If you're not getting a good representative that is a sitting member already, then I believe that there should be a grassroots movement to change candidates if they're not happy with that candidate. I think both parties and all parties want the best possible candidate to represent the constituency in their riding. And sometimes, and I agree with a lot of the points that you made, we want the best MPs, and they're not only for the constituents, but they're running the whole country, and they're working for all of us, because we, the taxpayers, are paying their salary, so they represent all of us when they make major choices that affect us. So,
And I recognize that. I just harken back to one or two examples that I won't really get into, but where a more right-wing contingent was able to take hold of the nomination mm-hmm. process over sure. a sitting member.
Yeah, and
it's not something I think
the Conservative Party that there probably needs to be a lot more support for MPs. I think that it looks pretty bad that the Prime Minister waited over a week to respond. It was floating around in the public. That doesn't look good on him, and it doesn't make his own base, his own members, feel confident.
Well, I mean, Alex, I'm sure he would hope that the issue would be resolved on its own in a more amicable fashion.
You hope so.
But
I
think that with new ridings being created, there should have been talks with inside your party first. There should have been all kinds of conversations.
Alex,
and
I can tell you, being in a party that being in a riding that is being split into two and going into a new one, there are talks all around. There are guidelines that you have to follow, and clearly, this particular MP did not follow them at all.
All right, just one. We're down to just a couple of minutes. Last topic, Ron, and it has to do with the marijuana muddle. Let's call it that. Where the government has instituted or plans to institute a new law that allows commercial growers to grow medical marijuana. Individuals who are growing their own are going to be stopped from doing that. They have to purchase from these legitimate growers. And they have appealed to the courts. The courts have now issued an injunction essentially allowing people to keep growing, which of course takes away from the commercial enterprise because now they've got thousands of perhaps competitors diminishing their return on investment because it is a business. Ron, what do you make of that? Just poorly thought through or what?
I understand where the government is coming from, and I understand where the users that are using medical marijuana to alleviate pain. Under the 2000 Supreme Court decision that to make this constitutional, that the government should do everything in its power to provide medical marijuana to people that have been prescribed to use it.
Tara.
We did not expect this ruling from the Supreme Court of Canada, and we're going to be fighting it. I think that this is best prepared for by larger corporations to give to the public as opposed to them growing it themselves.
I think Harper needs to quit wasting taxpayers' dollars by holding this up in the courts, and really they need to just be starting to look at ways to improve the program. No one has spoke better on this than NDP MP Libby Davies.
Yeah. I thought you were going to say
she's been an enormous champion. And one of the things that she's certainly questioning is why we're taking away individuals' ability to grow their own plants. 64% of participants who of this program currently grow their own, and they grow it for their specific needs.
Yeah, but we can't monitor who actually uses it, Alex, and that's the issue.
I think that this is all about commercialism here. You look at the cost of a gram when it's commercialized,
regulation.
It's $8.80, whereas currently it's around $2.30 to $5.
It's the Dallas Buyers Club all over again.
So who's going to be able to afford this? And when you're sick, you really don't have money to begin with.
That's true.
Well, fair enough. We'll see how this plays out because, as Tara pointed out, it is being challenged by the government in the courts as well, and we'll see how this develops. It is a wrinkle, though. But you know what, panel? Now it's my turn, and I'd like to opine on an issue that's hit the at least the social media airwaves over the last little while, as well as it sees city council to some extent. And it has to do with the whole raft of issues around the automobile and the role of the automobile in the city of Hamilton. We know that there has been a huge push to build some bike lanes on Cannon Street, the Yes We Cannon initiative, which was approved by council, $1 million or so, to build some safe bike lanes. But we've also seen that Queen Street, where there have been a couple of very serious accidents, has been targeted for a two-way conversion, along with many other streets around the city. And the words that are being used by the bike enthusiasts isn't, let's make it safe for us. It almost is, let's make it less convenient for cars because we don't need those lanes anyway, and let's make it safe while we're making it less convenient for them. So the question then has been raised in the media, the mainstream media, is there really a war on cars in the city of Hamilton? I think that's foolish to suggest that that is the case. I think our streets need to be safe for everybody, but we also need to recognize that they were primarily built for automobiles to get around. And so how can we accommodate that without infringing on the safety of others? What do you think, Ron?
Well, this has been going on for 25, 30 years because when the sidewalks were reconstructed on James Street North, they put on all these bump outs. And this was even before I was on council. And everyone wanted that to happen. This was when the street was one way. And they wanted to slow down traffic. Now, with a two-way system and no bike lane on James Street, traffic has really slowed down.
This has been a long time coming.
I noticed all the poles and the zebra stripe. They want to make it pedestrian-friendly for people. You don't want to be walking on a highway like Main Street right now. I work on Main and King, right at the corner of Victoria where St. Patrick's school is, and Main Street is a highway.
It's a highway that goes
60 kilometers an hour. Hey,
they're going more than 60 kilometers.
And let me tell you, I'm right on our house is right on Queen Street, so Queen and Main were directly affected by the traffic. My issue is with those intersections themselves, not the one-way traffic on Queen. Queen is not meant to be two-way, and I really hope that the Citizen Council that comes together can see that. There is a little bit of a war on cars. I don't like driving in the North End where you have all those zebra things.
30 kilometers an hour.
Where are you going to go?
And
really going 40 kilometers, 50 kilometers. You have to be an attentive driver. You have to watch out for pedestrians and for cyclists. If we have an issue, have higher fines, penalties for drivers that create infractions. And for cyclists, too. But, I mean, putting me down to a standstill isn't going to get Hamilton anywhere fast.
Alex.
Larry, I think that roads weren't built for the automobile. They were built for people to get us from point A to point B in the quickest way possible.
And
that doesn't seem to be what's happening today. Certainly, the automobile used to get us places quickly at one point, but today is exactly as Tara highlights, we're at a standstill. We're sitting in traffic for hours. I think that we need more transit, more public transit. That's the way to go. Similar to Ken Livingston, former mayor of London, UK, he did Red Ken. He implemented an amazing transit system in London. It's the envy of many cities around the world. And I think that's what we need to be doing here is certainly beefing up our transit, helping people to get from point A to point B as quick as possible.
All right. Well, thanks for your opinions. And if it is a war on cars, the car seems to be winning. That's the part that we need to reconcile. But thanks for your opinion, panel. And thank you for watching The Opinionators for tonight. We are going to be back actually 2 weeks from tonight,
week,
right? Production, not next week.
Next week.
We are back next week.
Yep.
We are back next week for more opinions from our expert panel. See you then. That's right.
Yeah,
it's 2 weeks
gonna,
that
you're
we're
gonna
done.
You're going to be missing
a week vacation, but I'm leaving on Thursday and coming back on Thursday.
Well, you can. We're going to have to Skype you in like they do, what's his name, on CBC.
Oh, that would, you know what?
Wouldn't
maybe
that be
we'll
fun?
That. We'll
wouldn't
try.
That be fun?
Mexico,
actually, wouldn't that be fun?
Yeah, just put the iPad right here.
And just so then you can just shut me off when you don't want to hear me.
Yes.